The many interactions between East and West are often some of the most fascinating histories in the ancient world, and we discussed one such account in a previous video. The War of the Heavenly Horses was a key moment in Hun expansion to the West. It connected the Hellenistic world created by Alexander the Great to the ancient Chinese civilizations of the East for the first time and opened the Silk Road. However, this was not the end of that particular story, a story which would conclude with a golden age of flourishing trade between East and West, and Han envoys almost reaching the territory of the Roman Empire. Shout out to True Legend Studio for sponsoring this video on Chinese history. Discover the legendary Chinese general Han Xin, who never lost a battle in this groundbreaking docudrama. Through dramatic reenactments, reconstructed battle scenes, and detailed historical research, Season 1 of the 5,000 Years of Heroes series takes you to the battlegrounds that built China's Han Dynasty. In 11 episodes, it follows the rise of Han Xin, from a low-ranking officer to one of China's greatest generals. His military brilliance, courage, and loyalty made him legendary. Han Xin mastered Sun Tzu's art of war and applied it to every strategy. In just over 4 years, he conquered all of China and brought Liu Bang, the future Emperor Gaozu, to power. He achieved incredible victories and built the Han Dynasty before he was 30 years old. Later generations called him the God of War. Support our channel and buy the Han Xin digital series by clicking the link in the description below. The Chinese victory in Fergana had prompted dozens of small Tarim Basin kingdoms to submit to Han protection, renouncing any previous loyalty they had to the nomadic Xiongnu. The Hohenshu, otherwise known as the Book of the Later Han, explains that the western regions were awed by Chinese military strength and wealth. They bared their heads and kneeled down towards the east to pay homage to the Son of Heaven, the Han Emperor. With the Tarim Basin now subject to Chinese rule, Han envoys in charge of state expeditions began to travel even further west, eventually nearing the frontiers of another great empire, the Parthian Empire. Two generations followed, consolidating Chinese control and economic influence in the Tarim Basin. Permanent military garrisons were established by the Chinese in the main oasis settlements of the Tarim Basin. In addition to simple housing for troops, these were also farming colonies, tasked with producing surplus food as provisions for state-authorized travelers, official caravans, and military campaigns launched by the Han Dynasty. Initial colonies of roughly 500 men were slowly grown over time. Each of the soldiers was accompanied by their families and were granted costly agricultural equipment paid for by the Imperial Chinese government. By undertaking land reclamation and irrigation, it was hoped that marginal land would be increased in quality and brought under cultivation with the use of innovative new farming technologies and water management strategies. Enriched by decades of increased caravan traffic and Chinese tribute, the Tarim kingdoms entered a new phase of urban expansion and economic growth under Han auspices. Initial caravans to take advantage of this new prosperous climate were state-managed operations, with travelers engaged in transporting diplomatic gifts and tribute between distant realms. However, private merchants quickly began to walk the path paved by the Han state, and were soon after officially permitted to travel along the caravan routes. This increasingly brought traders together from all parts of Inner Asia, who all sought to engage in the widespread exchange of merchandise. This prosperity increased gradually before events on the steppe prompted the most far-flung imperial venture in almost a century. In 56 BC, a Xiongnu warlord known as Ji Ji seized the throne from his governor, Hu Hanye, who subsequently appealed to the Han Chinese for assistance, offering to pledge loyalty to China if it was given. He received large amounts of gold, silk, and grain, and used this material advantage to obtain support from the steppe tribes and reclaim authority in Mongolia. Faced with imminent defeat, Ji Ji and a large band of followers fled into the distant west, eager to occupy lands far from the reach of both his brother and the Han Empire. By 40 BC, the exiled Xiongnu faction settled in a quite troublesome spot for the Chinese, on steppe grasslands several hundred miles north of Sogdia on the shores of Lake Balkhash, located in modern Kazakhstan. Gigi's nomads then made an alliance with the Kangju Sogdians, who were reportedly capable of fielding a force of 80,000 skilled archers. Their involvement with the rebellious nomads was therefore a burgeoning threat to Chinese interests in Central Asia. In order to cement his rule in the region, Gigi built a capital called the Chanyu Fortress, a palace complex strategically placed at a site west of the Ili River, which flowed into Lake Balkhash. From this base, the Xiongnu began to extend their authority into Transoxiana. In this period, the Han commander in the Tarim regions was known as the Protector General, an official who was expected to manage relations between China and the many kingdoms in the region. When Protector General Gan Yanshou learned of the Xiongnu incursions, he decided not to react due to the unprecedented remoteness of the territories in question. However, when he became ill, Gan's deputy, Chen Tang, seized the opportunity and prepared to launch a military expedition against them instead. In 36 BC, mobilization of a 40,000 strong army from the numerous vassal kingdoms began, and the troops converged on Kashgar. By the time Protector General Gan Yanshou learned of this, it was far too late. He was in quite a situation. This expedition had not been sanctioned by the Emperor, and the Protector General knew that he faced the death penalty for exceeding his authority. So he had no choice but to go along with the military venture and hope that a glorious victory would excuse his failure to control his subordinates. It was a grueling 500-mile, 30-day-long march to the enemy stronghold across the steppe from Kashgar, and they would not be unopposed. As the Han column travelled along its route, it was attacked by a large force of Kangju raiders, fighting in alliance with the rebel Xiongnu. While this did not impede Chinese progress too much, such harrying attacks must have inflicted casualties. When the Chinese eventually reached Chanyu Fortress, Gigi paraded his forces in front of the outer timber defences, hoping to buy more time for his steppe allies to arrive. Both the Kangju and Xiongnu armies fought as horse archers, so it was a surprise to the Han when they caught sight of disciplined infantry within the enemy formation. Historian Sima Chen reported that roughly 100 of these enigmatic infantry displayed a fish-scale battle formation, overlapping their shields in a manner which reminded the observers of scales from a Chinese carp. In 1957, an Oxford professor named Homer Dubbs suggested that this small unit of melee fighters could have been made up of a group of Roman legionaries. The theory is that after the Battle of Carrhae, Roman prisoners settled by the Parthians at Merv subsequently escaped from their captors and served as paid mercenaries for the Xiongnu. Furthermore, this fish-scale formation could possibly have been the famous testudo. This contingent was too small in number to affect the outcome of the battle, and they retreated within the walls with the rest of Gigi's army. As the battle began, well-drilled Chinese crossbowmen and archers pinned down Xiongnu defenders on the walls with a storm of bolts and arrows, while the melee infantry advanced behind a line of oversized shields to the fortification. As the Han forces were about to breach the outer walls, a force of enemy horsemen tried to sortie from their position, but were driven back by missile fire. The first line of defenses fell quickly after, and Xiongnu forces withdrew to the inner citadel. There, Gigi issued weaponry to his queen, concubines, and courtiers. After a 10,000 strong Kangju relief force was driven off by the use of flank fortifications and more missile fire, Gigi was injured in the face with an arrow and died soon after. His queen and crown prince were taken alive into Han custody. So, possibly without even realizing, the Chinese had their first contact with Romans, but it was not to be for almost a century that contact was almost made again. A power struggle in the Han government in 9 AD deposed the Han and led to a prominent official named Wang Mang seizing power. When this usurper asked the Tarim kingdoms to recognize his rule, they refused and broke away from Chinese control. This period did not last long, and the Han were able to reclaim the throne in 23 AD. However, it was to be several more decades before they could successfully restore the western regions to Han control. When they were finally brought back under control in the late 1st century AD, Chinese armies, led by Protector General Ban Chao, once again began campaigning further west, as far as the Pamir Mountains which separated the Tarim territories from ancient Afghanistan. On these exploratory ventures, Han officers began to receive odd reports from foreign dignitaries and merchants they encountered, suggesting that while the Chinese had been engulfed in internal strife, an incredibly powerful empire had emerged in the west. Hard to believe as it must have been to the proud Chinese, reports began to come in that this mysterious new empire was just as large and powerful as the glorious Han dynasty. Therefore, Chinese commanders called this great Western Empire Dachin, or Great China. The empire was, of course, the Roman Empire. Information about this enigmatic new Western mirror of the Middle Kingdom was recorded in the Hohanshu. Unlike many steppe nations, it was recorded the Romans cropped their hair and wore embroidered clothes. It also adds that the people of this country are tall and honest, they resemble the people of the Middle Kingdom, and this is why the state is called Dachin. The Han also received scattered pieces of information about the Roman state, its people, and its government apparatus in a somewhat fragmented way. The Hohanshu stated that the people of Dachin are honest in business, possess a good supply of grain and foodstuffs, and have an abundant reserve of resources. Chinese officials were also informed of the effective Roman postal system, which we know today as the cursus publicus, used to convey dispatches across the imperial domains. Foreign contact and diplomacy were said to be welcomed heartily by Dachin, and envoys approaching their borders from other nations would be routinely presented with gold coins and escorted to their destinations. We can barely imagine what the Chinese, relatively isolated in their ancient civilizational bubble in the east, thought when they discovered this mysterious and gigantic empire in the far, far west. We know that Greeks viewed India as almost the end of the world, and their knowledge of what was beyond this point even passed into the mythological. Perhaps rumors spread similar to the later Christian speculation about the kingdom of Prester John, or perhaps the Chinese simply viewed Dachin as their own dualistic mirror on the other side of the world, in line with the concept of yin and yang. Of course, the economic potential and trade goods of Rome were of key importance to the Han, whose interest is shown by the entire section of the Hohanshu dedicated to valuable products traded by the merchants of the Great Western Empire. Plentiful supplies of gold, silver, gems, and rare fabrics were traded, amongst many other things. Perhaps the most curious trade good in the Han source is byssus, a material derived from the filaments excreted by a large, rare species of Mediterranean clam known as Pinna nobilis. This substance was used by the creature to anchor itself onto rocks on the seabed, and could be spun into delicate, golden-colored, silk-like material which was both lighter and finer than regular silk. All of these products were traded in Roman cities, of which the Chinese also had scattered descriptions. Accounts of the glorious capital of Dachin were mixed, confused descriptions of Rome, but they intermingled with facts about the leading cities of Antioch and Alexandria. Since they were in the east, it is natural that merchants and envoys closer to China would have been there. Reports of Dachin's prosperity and power suggested that this mystery empire in the west might be a valuable ally and a lucrative trading partner for the Han if only the Chinese could find them. Seeking to discover more about it, and possibly even hoping to establish direct contact, Protector General of the Western Regions Ban Chao sent a subordinate named Gang Ying to the west in 97 AD. He was to serve as an official Han envoy, and was given the task of establishing contact with the Roman government. This emissary gathered an entourage and set out from the Tarim Kingdom's west, traveling along the caravan routes which led from the Pamir Mountains into Afghanistan. After crossing Iran, Gan Ying eventually reached a region which he knew as Tiao Ji, which is known to us as Karakene. This land was next to the Persian Gulf and sat almost on the western frontier of Anxi, the Parthian Empire. At this point in the journey, the Han delegation took stock of their situation. Their own patchy intelligence suggested that the borders of Dai Qin lay somewhere beyond the Indian Ocean's western edge. Therefore, Gan Ying reasoned that by traveling south, it would be possible to reach the territory of Rome. Unfortunately for the Chinese mission, this incomplete view of the world oversimplified the maritime route to Rome's empire, as they had no knowledge about the intervening Arabian Peninsula. Inquiring with the sailors in Karakene, Gan Ying asked to sail to Rome, a request which must have been met with confused faces and unsatisfactory responses. The sailors spoke unfamiliar languages, making clear communication with them quite difficult. Eventually, after much unsuccessful translation, some of the sailors eventually offered passage to Roman lands in Egypt via the Red Sea, while others assumed that he wanted to reach the city of Rome itself by sailing all the way around Africa. The sailors informed Gan that in favorable conditions, it would take a minimum of 3 months by ship to reach his destination. However, if the winds delayed and slowed down the ships, it could take around 2 years. Even worse, the Chinese would have to pay large amounts of money for extensive provisions, since all men who went by sea to Rome took supplies for 3 years. When the envoy heard this, he quickly abandoned all plans to reach the Roman Empire by sea, before beginning his long journey back to Chinese territory. What Gan Ying did not realize was that Parthia and Rome shared a common land border in the west. At his westernmost checkpoint in Karakene, the Chinese delegation was only 40 days' travel from the Roman frontier in Syria. When Gan Ying eventually returned to his superior Ban Chao and reported what had happened, the Protector General concluded that Rome was, in fact, too distant to assist the Chinese in their efforts to control Central Asia or be a valuable ally. This failed enterprise was the only known effort by the Han regime to make direct contact with the Roman Empire. The two great states had been so close, but it was not to be. However, indirect economic exchange and trade would continue, the details of which will be elaborated upon in our upcoming videos. Thanks for the sponsorship from True Legend Studio. Remember, you can watch the Han Xin series by clicking the link in the description below. New videos on Roman and Chinese history are on the way, so make sure you are subscribed to our channel and have pressed the bell button. We would like to express our gratitude to our Patreon supporters and channel members who make the creation of our videos possible. Now, you can also support us by buying our merchandise via the link in the description. This is the Kings and Generals channel, and we will catch you on the next one.